Hello everybody, today I'm going to show you how to make a truly fantastic recipe. I'm really talking here about Michelin star quality. It is that subtle and refined, you will amaze your guests with it. Depending on size, you can use it just as well for a starter as for a main dish. And what is also very good, while it is not difficult at all, you can make a lot of the things a day in advance, so that when your guests arrive, you have plenty of time to be with him, with them. So it's based around scallops, which I think most people will love. I will use, as you will see, deep frozen scallops because it's difficult for me to get really fresh ones. If you can do that, have fresh ones, then of course it's even better. If you use, like me, deep frozen ones, well then, important, once they are decongelated, you have to tap them dry. Otherwise, they cook rather than bake. So, what is the dish? It's pan-roasted scallops with a cauliflower puree. And also, very, very unique, raisin caper tapenade. Which is which sounds unbelievable, but it's amazing. Now here, this is where I discovered that recipe, and this is the book Sunday Lunch from Gordon Ramsay, you know, the, of course, the TV chef, well, not only TV chef, the chef with the outspoken personality, let's put it. I thought it was his recipe, and it's well possible that it is purely his. But this book is from 2006, and meanwhile, I discovered in another one of my too many cookbooks, in this book from Jean-Georges Vongerichten, which was from the year 1998, almost the same recipe actually. As you can see here, scallops and cauliflower with caper raisin sauce. It's almost the same actually what it is. A few tiny differences. So I don't know, maybe, I don't know actually who invented it, but it doesn't matter. It's probably one of these two guys, because this is a thoroughly modern dish. And like I say, very subtle, very elegant. When you serve it, by the way, because otherwise I forget to tell you at the last moment, take a white wine that hasn't seen oak. That is a pure, clean, crisp white wine. And I would rather go for a French white wine with a more, let's say, subdued taste than a more exuberant new world wine. That's what I would recommend. Here, by the way, Jean-Georges Vongerichten, also a fantastic chef. He's from France and actually became quite well known in America with very adventurous cuisine, often where he mixes his French savoir-faire with Asian techniques and ingredients. So quite an interesting cookbook. So this is a bit of the background. So and like I will show you, we can do a few things ahead, and I will do that indeed, because I'm actually going to finish the dish and do the baking of the scallops tomorrow at friends, and I will try to film there the last part. So now the prep. First, one of the simplest things that you will need to make is a bit of a vinaigrette, so a little vinegary sauce. And you need for that, well, this is sherry vinegar. If you really don't find sherry vinegar, then use balsamic vinegar. That's good enough. This is, by the way, this is a tablespoon. One of those measurement spoons. I think it's 15 milliliter. What is really important in general when you make a vinaigrette, most often, it is best to have one portion vinegar on three portions of olive oil. That is usually the good ratio to have the good ratio of sourness. So that was one tablespoon of the sherry vinegar. And if you can read this, by the way, it is a small amusing detail. These are the measurement spoons from El Bulli ingredient kit, which I've been experimenting in the past. So one, two, three, free. And that is definitely enough for a meal with multiple people, because we will only sprinkle a bit on it at the very end. Of course, I forgot to take a plate to put it, so I have to stand up and take a bit of paper towel here for the spoon. I will need to edit this video anyway, so I leave this now here. And what we also do, it's not in the recipe, but I think it's better, is add a bit of freshly ground pepper. Voilà. And we pour that into a little bottle or whatever thing that you want. But I've got one of those nice bottles to easily sprinkle sauce with. Voilà. So this will be the dressing at the very end. Simple, and you can also use this combination on a salad. So that is the first thing. Let's do this out of sight now. And this as well. Sorry for the small weight. Now we're doing something else. And that I will need to cut to show you the next step. Take a pan and we use the equal weights of raisins. I prefer actually the golden ones. These are around a good 60 grams of raisins. That's enough for 4 people typically. Capers. So that's the ones that I measured the weight of to get the weights the same. Ah yeah, the capers, by the way, not straight from the pot. I put them in a sieve and I rinse them with clean water, so that otherwise the overly sour bite, you could say, from the vinegar would otherwise be too overpowering. So that's important to rinse it, the capers. And then the same weight of water. Voilà. So what we will do next is bring this to the boil and stir a bit with a wooden spoon. Once it's to the boil, you get it off the fire and put it in a blender. That's what I will show next. So as you can see, I'm actually heating and stirring a bit so that it doesn't burn the capers. It's capers, it's not peas, which the color correction of the camera makes it maybe seem too green. So until it boils, it's almost there, and then I put it in the blender. You will be amazed by this sauce. It is sweet, sour, and almost nobody can guess exactly what's in it. Some people guess the capers, nobody guesses the raisins. Try it maybe next for a salad or something, instead of mustard, if you would add that otherwise. So, it's almost there. So here, I put the hot mix into a blender. Put the lid on the blender, watch out, because it's hot, eh? So. So, I admit that this doesn't look very appetizing. It's a bit grey-green, but honestly, you will see that it is very good. So, what I will do here, I put this in a kind of a Tupperware pot, and tomorrow I will just heat it up, just for serving. So, you can perfectly do that a day in advance. Okay, now the cauliflower, what do we need to do with that? As you can see, I'm now for the cauliflower puree, I'm now melting butter in the pan. And there is cauliflower in the other pan that I just have there ready. As soon as all the butter is nicely melted, I will add the cauliflower. For the cauliflower, if you are with four people, then half a head of the florets roughly chopped is good enough. But I will, in this case, make the puree of the whole head. And I eat it separately. So it's a good chunk of butter that you need there. Okay. So I added the cauliflower to the pan with the molten butter. And I sauté, meaning the fire is pretty hot. And I keep on stirring so it doesn't burn. So that all the pieces of cauliflower are also coated a bit with the butter. In the end, I also had to add a tiny bit more butter. That can happen. There will be, by the way, no potatoes in this puree. It's just cauliflower and a few other things. By the way, Jean-Luc Vongerichten uses also a bit of nutmeg here. I don't do it, and Gordon Ramsay, that's the recipe I'm following. Well, they are otherwise very similar. Eh? Doesn't use it either, actually. And I don't think the nutmeg would help here for all the subtle flavors of the rest. But, I mean, it's up to you, as always. So, I do this for 3 to 4 minutes. So, I will now add a good splash of milk. I use full fat milk for this, no lighter milk, because I think this improves the taste, a tiny bit more even. And what we do, we cover the pan, lower the fire a bit, and let it sweat. Well, I will just stir it once more after I stop the camera for this. So, it has sweated a bit. Next step is, we add some cream. 100 ml is enough for half a head. I use here a full 250 ml bottle for the big head of cauliflower that I had. So that's quite okay. I actually recommend to use a light cream, because otherwise it can be a relatively heavy dish. And also when you use it light, it's also much better when you use it as a starter, so that people are not totally feeling totally filled up yet. So stirring a bit. So what I will do now, I bring this to a gentle boil again, the cream, and I will then afterwards partly cover the pot again with the lid and let it gently bubble, you could say, for another few minutes. What's important then after this, that the florets, the cut-up florets, must be relatively soft, because we will need to mix them with the mixer and to do it nicely. So that's the next. So what I'm doing now is actually, the florets have gone soft. I use a mixer to puree it all. If you've got a food processor, that also works. It's best to do this when it's still hot. Otherwise, it's much more difficult. So in essence, you really make the puree a real puree. And I also added quite a bit of black pepper to it that I sprinkled over it. In essence, the puree is now ready. I will put it in also kind of a Tupperware pot. When it has cooled down, I put it in the fridge. So everything that we've seen until now, the dressing, the special caper and raisin tapenade, and here the cauliflower puree, you can all make a day in advance. So then you really have very little to do the next day, as we will soon see when you see me baking the grilling the scallops and then putting everything on the plates. Put it in the fridge then afterwards if you do it the day before, but I would say don't put the cauliflower in the deep freezer. I don't know, I have the impression that it does something on the taste. So, it's now the next day. I'm at my friend's place. We've seen all the preparations. The scallops here, As I told you, I patted them dry with a bit of paper towel, because then it's better in the pan, otherwise they cook. And I sprinkled them with a bit of curry powder. So we will now do the hot part of the recipe. Hot pan, important. When you do cook with olive oil, first have the pan hot before you add the olive oil. I hope I've got enough of olive oil, but the scallops are still a bit moist, so that should be okay. Let's just coat the pan, and it doesn't need so much time to we don't have extra oil, I think. Okay, well, we will do it with this. So coat it a bit. Okay, bon. And now there is one trick with scallops. If you want to put scallops in a pan, it's important that you don't cook them too long, because then they become rubbery. So we will now add the scallops to the pan, and there is one important trick to do that. You put them in, because you shouldn't cook them too long, otherwise they become rubbery. And how do you do that? Well, you put them actually in a kind of a spiral in the pan, and by the time you've done the last one, it's more or less time to start turning them. And roughly 1 to 1.5 minutes per side. And this makes exactly the good sound that I was hoping for. That's why you need a hot pan. So we are now with 3 persons. And we will have this as a main dish. And now we each have 4 nice big scallops per person, which is a luxurious dinner, I would say. I wait a bit more, because they are really big and still a bit cold. Well, it's about time, I think, to start turning them. You see, and I start, and look at that color that it has. That is exactly what we are looking for. We start with the first one that we put in the pan. Like I say, the most important thing is that you don't overcook them. Okay. But I can still have a bit more. You can also, with this kind of big scallops, slice them in half, so that you have a thinner slice to put in the pan. That is also possible. The scallops are okay. I will put the fire down, and now we actually move a bit sideways. I will show you how to dress the first plate. So I put the pan off the heated area, but still hot enough, of course. So what we do, because in this case we have four scallops per person. This is the heated cauliflower puree that you saw me making earlier. We put 4 nice spoonfuls on the plate. Voilà. On each of them we put a scallop. And the taste, you will notice, it's really marvelous. It's very subtle, I mean, how the taste goes together. So. And now we add a bit of the special tapenade that you also saw me making earlier in the program. I also heated that. And so I did that just in the microwave, both things heating. And And you see, that's why actually at the moment of cooking you have very little work, which is fun. Bon. And then finally, first thing I made was the dressing, yeah, the sherry vinaigrette. Well, a few hearty splashes, and the dish is ready. So this is the first dish. I will now do the other dishes. I can really recommend this when you have friends around, and you will notice that the people, when they taste it, will soon start make noises that you associate rather with X-rated movies. Thank you. And